Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present The Churchgoer, a novel by Patrick Coleman. Performed by Chris Ciulla. And what remains when disbelief has gone? Grass, weedy pavement, brambles, buttress, sky. A shape less recognizable each week. A purpose more obscure. Philip Larkin, Church Going. San Diego, one of the most beautiful harbors in the world, and nothing in it but navy and a few fishing boats. At night, it is fairyland. The swell is as gentle as an old lady singing hymns. Raymond Chandler, The Long Goodbye. 1. When I first saw Cindy Lou standing on a street corner in Oceanside, trying to thumb a ride out of town, I wondered why a young woman like her was hitchhiking. But I didn't think it was any great mystery. Bad boyfriend, bad drugs, bad job, bad upbringing, bad decision-making, bad luck, or maybe a misguided optimism, a romantic attraction to the 60s, or some other brief bohemian flowering that rose up between the paving stones of greed or progress or those other more direct forms of bloodletting. A few facts between not known and known, that's all. A puzzle. But this isn't about puzzles. It was morning. The sky was mottled gray like a well-used rag. The day was threatening rain, but only in that imprecise Southern California way. The cloud cover could be fog off the sea, a marine layer set to burn off in the afternoon, or an honest-to-God rain cloud. A rare enough prospect that most of us don't believe in them until the first drop hits our face. It was impossible to know whether the overcast would evaporate with the day or not. As the heavy traffic to the beach attested, everyone hoped. Everyone demanded that it would.
I'd gone to Angelo's for breakfast after an early morning surf at North Jetty.
The floor and counters in Angelo's were red and white ceramic tile, or had been before the white had yellowed and the red browned. In the kitchen, visible beyond the counter, a loose piece of lettuce skittered on the griddle. A man wearing a red t-shirt and white apron sang,
"Cocino dos hamburguesas en la mañana. Yo cocino dos hamburguesas en la noche."
To the steady slap and sizzle of flipped, flaring meats. It smelled like fry oil and oregano. I liked their self-serve coffee pot, something you don't see much anymore. One of those industrial ones with the brown-rimmed glass for regular. If asked for decaf, they'd send you down the block and question your dignity as you left, as was only right. I ordered a breakfast burrito and coffee, filled the chip mug, and made my way to a window booth that looked out over Pacific Coast Highway. On my way in, I'd noticed a woman across the street, and she was still there by the pitched roof of the Wiener Schnitzel. Between us was stalled traffic heading in both directions, one hers and the other not. Behind her, the ketchup and mustard umbrellas looked like a clutch of cocktails abandoned by a party of friends. I don't know what that made her. Stray olive, maybe? She wore a yellow t-shirt and cutoffs, and her hair was short and black. A cardboard sign I couldn't read was wedged into her hip. There's a person with a cardboard sign for every block of Coast Highway, but that was especially true here, by the freeway on-ramp and off-ramp. People were always coming and going from downtown Oceanside. It was the first southbound pit stop after the long, dusty expanse of the Camp Pendleton Marine Base, a place for those new recruits to let off steam. The most directly accessible beach on which the inland invasion from Temecula, Murrieta, and Hemet could mount their temporary assault. An easy town to hop a train, in one of the cars or on one, and ride south toward the border, or north to Los Angeles. It was a good place to get a tattoo, if you didn't care about spelling or aesthetics. A good place to find a motel that charged by the hour. Or it was one of the places where you lived if you worked in San Diego and couldn't afford other options. It wasn't a place many people stayed if they could help it. I like that about it. Maybe like is too strong a word. Anyway, I was one of those broke people, in more ways than one. So a hitchhiker with a sign, taking in some lungfuls of exhaust and the tepid, sickly smell of hot dog water was unremarkable enough. She was attractive, though, and I wasn't against looking. The voice of the Greek woman behind the counter called out that my order was ready. The way she said it, without a pause, made it sound like my first name was the food I was about to eat.
Breakfast burrito, Mark! Breakfast burrito, Mark!
It made me glad I hadn't ordered Tony's special. I got up, took my tray, and snagged a napkin and a bottle of tapatio on my way back to the booth. Across the street, the woman tapped a sign against her calf. She was probably 22 or so, I guessed.
I peeled back the paper on my burrito,
took two shallow bites, and filled the hole with hot sauce. A car full of young men pulled off in front of her, and she leaned into the passenger window. With the red sedan in the way, I couldn't see much until it lurched back into the traffic, which was suddenly moving again. There she was, in the flashes between the passing cars, a fountain drink exploded at her feet, raising a middle finger to taillights. She craned her back, lifting the bird on high to make sure they saw it, and said some words that I couldn't hear, but that were, in a more elemental way, intelligible enough. She took a black hoodie from her backpack and wiped at her feet. She kicked the cup away, cursed some more, cleaned her kicking foot again, and lost her balance, falling onto one hip and flinging an arm up as overcompensating counterbalance. She talked to herself, seated on the concrete, stuffing the hoodie back in her bag. The traffic ground to a halt once more, and she vanished behind one of the beachbound cars. Bad drugs or bad booze, I decided. Poor kid. I went back to my food. Lost to my thoughts, meager as they were, and the bundle of grease and chilies I was eating, I hadn't noticed the young woman cross the street until she came through the door to Angelo's. The counter was unmanned, and she propped one arm against it and pivoted, swinging her hips back and forth. I tried not to look. Women can feel old eyes on them, and I didn't like being reminded of what I'd become. But then I would come to, wondering something not exactly ineffable about the frayed denim of her cutoffs. I poured more tapatio on my burrito and bit. She dropped her backpack on the ground and gave it a swift kick. Her worn t-shirt was more a vague impression of yellow over a black bra. Scowling at the menu, she mouthed the different options, squinting at off-putting items, debated her possibilities for an audience of one. She reminded me of someone, but I couldn't place it. I had a feeling she was never not conscious of being watched. Little did I know. It's hard not to think of her as I would later. Hair dyed, living under a different name. Those two versions of her phase in and out of each other, like the picture on my garbage television. It's hard not to wonder about the negative space between them, the lines of static, to ask what was real there. Everything else is a puzzle. That's the mystery. 2. The Greek woman emerged from the kitchen to attend to the customer. There was a bit of back and forth that I wasn't trying to hear, but then a pleading note emerged in the younger woman's voice. The woman behind the counter had her hands up, saying, "I can't, I can't." The hitchhiker gestured with her open wallet.
"I had money, I don't... Someone must have swiped it," she said. "I'm just trying to get a little something to eat. Please?"
Then it came back, an impression from what felt like another life. Hannah Trout, one of the small group leaders from the church I had led, and the way she would move from social circle to social circle, a kind word here, a prompting question there, a little shared anecdote about how prayer had helped her settle on her summer plans or pursue musical theater, and the look she'd given me when I'd taken her aside and questioned whether she was acting out of love for God or for the admiration of her peers.
"I don't know what you're talking about," she had said, looking at me in horror.
I asked her if she was too focused on trying to perform for everyone in this perfect way. Said that I wondered if she knew the envy it was creating in the other girls, how it was seen as flirting with the boys, how she might be putting personal motivations ahead of God's.
"What would you do," I had asked her, "if no one was watching?
Only God." Her expression went cold, tears just held in reserve.
"I was wrong," she said. "You don't know what you're talking about. There's always someone watching."
Then she left, found another leader to work with.
I know what she meant now. The impossible contortionist act asked of young evangelical women.
But this was toward the end of my pastoral career. A precursor, a warning sign, a kind of imprecation, before everything went dark.
No, I just can't,
the Greek woman said again to the hitchhiker. I hated these memories, their insidious tentacles, and forced them down someplace deep and dark. Memories never did any good. I needed them as much as water down Tabasco. The hitchhiker needed a burger, didn't have the cash. Fine. Her legs were thin and pale, I could see plainly. She probably could use the calories. The cardboard sign rested against the white backpack she'd set below the counter. In a blocky but still somehow fanciful hand were the words, Seattle? Take me. Going north? Take me. I'd like to say it wasn't the wiener schnitzel strength whiff of suggestiveness that got me to my feet. That wasn't all of it, of course. Caritas and cupiditas. Charity and cupidity. Make nasty but satisfied bedmates all the time. There's a lot going on inside a person in a given moment, but I had made a habit of helping people for a long time. And there was plenty down in there to be suspicious of, along with the one or two better impulses that had adapted to the lack of light and air. Like a couple ghost crabs warming their claws on a deep-sea thermal vent. Maybe it was that memory of Hannah, the servant leader. The look on her face, a history of disappointment there, working under the surface of my mind. It was my first mistake. I stood and walked toward the counter, trying to keep my gait slow, disinterested. I knew how to approach someone like this. When I was halfway there, I called out, "I need a little guac, Cass." Cass, the Greek woman behind the counter, told me without a glance to hold on a minute. Then she told the girl she was out of luck. I studied the menu board, pretended I hadn't a clue what they were talking about.
I'm not normally like this, the hitchhiker said,
in the slight shift of how her voice projected. A little bump in decibels and a new clarity in the sandpapered tone, I knew she'd turned and was speaking toward me, that her words were making a more direct route to my ear. Huh? I said, looking at her, and then back to Cass.
Sorry, Cass. Can you just give me the guac, and I'll come back and pay later? My hash browns are turning to asphalt over there.
The woman behind the counter mustered a look of complete disinterest, which was a step up from her usual expression of couldn't give a rat's ass. In my peripheral vision, the hitchhiker turned her body to face me more fully. She was making no secret of looking at me, was waiting for me to turn. I could see what was happening. She'd made a mark. It was like watching a tiger hunt meat in the zoo, which made me both the meat and the keeper with the meat on his fishing pole. I turned.
Hey, I'm sorry, man, she said.
There was a jangliness to how she spoke. Up close, she was pretty, young. There was a scatter of freckles across her nose, and her features made me think she was part Chinese, maybe. Her hair was swept across her forehead. It was dark and smooth.
Save the cowlick in the back
that almost made her look like a hungover teenage boy, but not quite.
I don't know what happened, she said, but I must have got robbed. I had money, and it's gone. Can you believe it?
I shrugged. Easy enough to believe in an empty wallet in Oceanside. She was turning on the ball of her hand so that her elbow kinked out, and she let her head fall to the side just a fraction, not quite doing the sad, cute ingenue thing, but doing just enough to suggest the idea. She was good.
I guess you're right. I was just trying to get a little bite to eat, you know?
She laughed, but didn't drop that note of sadness. It might have been phony, but she looked so pitiful doing it, it didn't matter.
And what? I said to Cass. You can't spare one of those B-grade frozen frisbees you've got in the back.
Cass looked about as moved as the Rock of Gibraltar.
Now it's one, then it's 20. So many bombs around here, and if people start figuring out we're a soup kitchen...
Burger kitchen, I said.
Whatever kitchen. Free kitchen, she said. Then we got a problem.
If it'll move this show along faster, I said, reaching for my wallet, let me pay for the thing.
Oh, you don't need to do that,
the hitchhiker said, but her voice was as thin as spider silk and as sincere as a celebrity's lavender marriage. I just made a noise and passed some money over. She folded her arms and smiled sweetly.
Man, that's incredible. You don't meet enough people like you, you know? Anyway, I can get a Coke too? I'm thirsty as hell.
I nodded and gave Cass some more money. Never understood that one. thirsty as hell. I'd be thirsty in hell. Maybe it was that I'd already paid. Maybe it was the joke. But the girl picked up her bag and backed away, and the ingenue vanished. Those sad eyes turned opaque, the way shop windows late in the day become mirrors reflecting Main Street. She looked like any teenager now.
Yeah, good point. Thanks, man,
she said tonelessly. She took her cup and made to go around me, beneath the scent of cigarettes that wafted off her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.